So as the term implies, blood and marrow transplantation is the transplantation or infusion of cells collected either from the blood or from the bone marrow. The cells in question are blood stem cells, cells that are going to go on and be able to create all of the cells in the blood and immune system lineage. And that's an important feature to delineate, that they're the stem cells that we're actually looking for. Stem cells can be collected from the bone marrow, which can be referred to as the stem cell factory, if you will, but they can also be collected from the peripheral blood, and they can also be collected from the placenta or the cord blood. So the combination of any one of those sources is an opportunity to transfuse these blood stem cells into a patient who may benefit from such a procedure. So blood stem cells can either be collected from the patient who ultimately receives them or from a suitably matched donor. When the blood stem cells are collected from the patient who ultimately receives the blood stem cell transplant, that's called an autologous bone marrow transplant. And when those blood stem cells are collected from a suitably matched donor, that is called an allogeneic bone marrow or blood stem cell transplant. Both of those options are available at Johns Hopkins. In addition, we would complete the transplants using any one of the stem cell sources. So we can collect stem cells from the bone marrow, we can collect stem cells from the peripheral blood, or we can collect blood stem cells from the placenta or the cord blood. We also use a variety of what are called conditioning regimens. Myeloablative or full intensity conditioning regimens are generally high dose chemotherapy and or radiation, but we can also offer blood stem cell transplants following what are called reduced intensity conditioning regimens. And they are generally a bit more gentle in terms of the complications that are seen after the blood stem cell transplant procedure and can be offered to patients who might not have malignant disorders. That gets us to the final types of transplants. So we offer transplants to patients who have malignant disorders, including leukemia and lymphoma. We also offer transplants to patients whose bone marrow is no longer working. They may have something called bone marrow failure syndromes, aplastic anemia, for example. We also offer blood stem cell transplants to patients with hemoglobinopathies. Their bone marrow may be functioning for the most part, but in essence making defective products. And then finally, we also offer blood stem cell transplants to patients whose immune system may be dysfunctional. Remember, these blood stem cells are going to give rise to all of the other cells in the blood and immune system. So if you have an immunologic disorder, a deficiency, or perhaps an immune disorder where the immune system is overactive, we can also offer life-saving, certainly life-changing, blood stem cell transplant procedures to those individuals as well. I think the biggest advance, not only at Johns Hopkins, but likely in the entire world today, is the use of half-matched related donor transplants. So heretofore, the approach to a blood stem cell transplant, if the donor was going to be someone other than self, a suitably matched donor, that donor needed to be what is called HLA matched. Not everyone has an HLA matched sibling. In fact, only about 25 or 30% of patients may have an HLA matched family member. If those patients don't have a suitably matched family member, there are unrelated donor registries, both using adults and also using cord blood that also can be tapped into. However, not everyone has a suitably matched unrelated donor. So the ability to actually use a half-matched donor in a safe, effective, and transportable way has not only been an innovation at Johns Hopkins, but this has changed the way we have done blood stem cell transplants across the globe over the last 5 to 10 years. And I think that, without question, is not only the biggest advance made at Johns Hopkins recently, but again, really one of the bigger advances made throughout the world in the last decade or so. The most important aspect of using a half-matched donor, half-matched related donor, is to be able to do this in a way that's safe and effective, and in fact doesn't take much manipulation of the bone marrow graft. Using half-matched donors in and of themselves is not new. People have been doing them for decades. However, results have not been optimal whatsoever. It turns out moving a very commonly used chemotherapeutic agent called Cytoxan, two doses of this medicine, to the post-transplant period, something we refer to as post-transplant Cytoxan, has allowed us to use these half-matched related donors in a way that, again, is safe, effective, and essentially allows everyone in need, just about everyone in need of a bone marrow transplant, to have a suitably matched donor. The most important thing is this is relatively inexpensive and is transportable. What I mean is you don't need fancy cell processing. You don't need to be in a necessarily in a tremendously advanced center. You can take this innovation and really apply it throughout the entire globe. So now we're doing these transplants in Eastern Europe, in Latin America, in Southeast Asia. So this again has enabled us to break down the traditional barriers to donor availability, not just here at Hopkins, but across the planet. So the way half-matched transplant is influencing patient care is really predicated on now we have broken down donor barriers. So now, if you don't have a suitably matched, traditionally suitably matched related donor, or a traditionally suitably matched unrelated donor, you still now have a donor for a blood stem cell transplant. So it is not unusual for us to see on YouTube or on social media, parents pleading for a match for their son or daughter. And I love to look at them or reach out to them and say, look in the mirror, you are the potential match. Because a mother or father is in fact biologically going to be half matched to their son or daughter. So if you're young, generally less than 50 years of age, and you're healthy, you can in fact be that suitable donor for a child in need. And I think by far, that has now allowed us to expand blood stem cell transplantation to patients, again, not only who have leukemia, lymphoma, but they may have non-malignant disorders. Again, aplastic anemia, where the bone marrow shuts down. Hemoglobinopathies, sickle cell disease, for example, beta thalassemia. The blood stem cells come to work. They make defective products. Now we can offer a life-saving blood stem cell transplant to almost all of these patients who are in need. And that is where Hopkins is moving the field forward. So this is an exciting time at the Children's Center and at the Sydney Kimmel Cancer Center. We are now using our half-matched reduced intensity platforms to transplant patients across the scope of malignant and non-malignant diseases. And in doing so, we are working to break traditional barriers to donor availability. In addition, we're doing cutting-edge bench-to-bedside research to make the transplant procedures safer. We want to reduce, prevent, or be able to treat potentially life-threatening complications that can sometimes associate with blood stem cell transplants. Whether you're receiving those blood stem cells from yourself, autologous bone marrow transplant, or from a suitably matched donor, allogeneic bone marrow transplant. In addition, we're working again in a bench-to-bedside manner to figure out ways to help train this new donor immune system to effectively recognize and eradicate residual host leukemia or tumor. This is a very well-known entity called graft versus leukemia or graft versus tumor effects. So we are working diligently to figure out ways to optimize graft versus leukemia effects and minimize innocent bystander casualties, something known as graft versus host disease. Finally, we're also working with with our colleagues in stem cell biology to be able to look at non-blood stem cells and look at their immune modulatory capacity and regenerative capacity to see if we can expedite healing of certain complications after the blood stem cell transplant procedure. So that is the mission that we're bringing forth in the pediatric blood and marrow transplant program. We work hand in hand with our colleagues in internal medicine, and I think that together is really a force to be reckoned with, not only here in the U.S., but globally as well.